Well, George, VAR.
Yeah, it's fun, isn't it?
You know what? I think it's another thing. People are blaming VAR, but it's actually it's the controversy that's coming out is it's how people are looking at the screen and seeing things that other people can't see.
I can understand where Tony Docherty was coming from, and it was.
We should say Dundee. A very sort of soft penalty was conceded at Ibrox, and then there was a debatable red card as well for Rangers.
Yeah, and Tony Docherty came in post match into Rangers' very plush new press conference facility, which is very nice.
It's always been nice at Ibrox.
They've changed it all now.
Put on a good spread usually.
Yeah, I was too late. I got stuck.
Don't let them know.
I got stuck in traffic and missed that.
Quite a good carry last time.
and that was his immediate. There was nothing about the performance immediately. It was straight into this problem with VAR, which and you can understand it because what a referee Ken Clancy has seen immediately is, I think it was a still of Donnelly pulling. Seema's shirt, which he shouldn't have done, really. I think in the age of VAR, it's always going to be a penalty, but I can understand where Tony Docherty's come from in terms of seeing the entire picture. The referee saw it at the time.
He did it first.
Yeah. So Seema was pulling Donnelly's jersey as well, but I think it was just a wee bit inexperience from a young defender that got kind of Seema was getting away from him, maybe, or he'd slipped, and he just kind of panicked a wee bit and pulled the shot. And at the time, obviously, Kim Clancy was looking right at it and decided that wasn't enough to be a penalty. But in the age of VAR, you just can't quite get away with it. And especially at a venue like
the referee.
Ibrox. I know.
That's what gets me. I think the whole VAR thing is actually coming down to the standard of referees.
Well, it's the guys that are implementing the rules. And these decisions are still subjective as well. So it comes down to the ability of that referee to judge that situation.
It's a really bizarre situation when you've got two players that kind of do the same thing to each other in the box, but because he's called over to the monitor, but he's not been called over to the monitor because of the foul that Seema, because of the tugging.
It's only the defender that gets punished.
Yeah, exactly. So it's almost like he has to ignore that one foul because that's not what he's there for and that's not what he's there to judge. And only look at the thing that happens, and it kind of, I don't know if that's technically the right decision. I guess probably it is, but it defies common sense.
It really does,
especially in a game where the love a rule. I mean, the SFA, FIFA, UEFA, everybody, a law. Sorry, I beg your pardon. They do love a law. Surely they could say, and there's an obvious starting point when there might be a potential penalty after a corner kick. Surely the first thing the referee should get shown is the incident starting with the corner in real time, and then the referee decides.
Yeah, you'd think so.
But I wonder, logically, I would go over and look at that incident and say, yes, a foul has happened, but it's happened after the Rangers player has done the same foul. So it should be a free kick to Dundee. But are they not allowed to do that because VAR isn't there to judge attacking fouls?
Well, that's the issue. Yeah, that could well be the issue, because it just feels like in open play a referee would just kind of ignore
it's
that
50, because 50,
it was 6-1 and a half, doesn't it? Because it happened at Kevin Clancy again, Rangers against Dundee, the other way around at Dens, and Rangers had obviously already won the game, and there was a tackle at the end that I think normally a referee would just go, right, this game's done. It would be a bit harsh, so I just haven't seen that, so we'll just ignore it. But you can't do that anymore with VAR, because VAR's just going to make you go and review it, and I think that's what happened in that game. There's a bit of that in both these decisions. Without VAR, I don't think it's a penalty, I don't think it's a red card. Obviously, on the pitch, those are the decisions Kevin Clancy went, and Kevin Clancy had a good game. Rangers fans were going mental about him in the second half, but I thought he was really good and quite strong. And got all the big decisions right, but VAR has obviously come in and said he's made errors, which I don't think he really did.
You're right; it's a subjective call, and I think he's got to give it. There's a freeze frame which is absolutely condemning. You know, we are effectively Aaron Donoghue has slipped. he has got a hold of Seymour's jersey, but it looks like he's pulled him to the ground. And there was none further from the truth. Look, see, the defenders at corners, you're always told, be touch tight. And the way defenders do that is just take a wee nip on a player's jersey. Yeah. Not to pull him back, just so you know where he is. And most players will do that in the in the past. But as soon as the player moves, then there is going to be a slight tug on the jersey. Yeah. It's whether that has affected his ability to actually get to the ball. The big problem that Clancy's got is as soon as he's told to go at the monitor, he's going to have to be a big man to not give that penalty kick. Because what he's going to get thrown back in his face is similar incidents that have taken place at previous games where there has been a penalty kick, you know. But I thought it was soft. I thought the sending off was soft. I've got to be fair as well. I don't think it was a malicious challenge. It looked worse than it was.
But with VAR, it's going to be a red.
Through VAR,
that's the thing.
So
I thought the sending off, they were so close together. I thought that in itself was a mitigation. It wasn't like...
And the referee was right there as well.
Uh-huh.
And gave a yellow immediately. So,
it's a disappointing one. And it's something that they've got to... But as long as we're down to subjective calls, and it takes a big man... Not to give the penalty if these incidents have been given before. What's the referee going to get thrown at him beyond this? Is he basically favouring one team against other teams? Have the referees got something for one team against other teams? That's what you're going to get thrown at you.
And then you also take in the Josh Mulligan incident against Kilmarnock when the referee was sent to the monitor and stuck with his decision.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But now it's been seen by an independent panel that was wrong. And then
I was very surprised with that one. That was a bit of a shock when he came back and says, "No, Josh, you're still going off." But going back to the game itself, Tom, Dundee will be really disappointed. I was really disappointed in the performance. I thought Tony Docherty sort of, he wasn't too harsh on them. But
I think it was a bit of good management though, in terms of post-match. Keep the focus on VAR, not very much on our defending.
You could feel it in his sort of... The undertones there were, we could have done a lot better there than we did. And it's one of the few games that I've actually thought, you know, I mean, obviously they score a great goal to begin with. They get their noses in front. Before that, Lyle Cameron almost scored a fantastic goal, great save from Jack Butland, which led to the corner, which led to Dundee going in front, but they just couldn't keep their... You know, you've got to keep yourself tight.
You've got to be perfect.
You know, a pure decision-making from Jordan McGee for the first goal where he basically heads it right back into play when he should be knocking the ball wide. And they're punished, and then Donnelly's punished for the penalty. And then he's not going anywhere near Seymour.
Yeah.
Actually, you know what, I would have thought... For that incident, obviously Donnelly's been penalised for holding Seymour. I would have thought it might even be worth switching. One of the centre-halfs, Shaughnessy or Lamy says, you come and pick up my man, I'll go and take Seymour on this kick. Maybe. Because Donnelly gave him far too much room for the second one, and he comes and powers into the net. And Dundee face an uphill battle. Obviously, Rangers get a man sent off right on the interval. And I thought, Dundee can really go and show what they're made of here, because they're a decent football inside, they can pass the ball, they can create opportunities, but they just did not do
that. They did pass it well, and they had more possession than Rangers.
They just did not do it, though, George. And you know, and I thought Docherty again, he's quick to make changes. He brings on Tiffany, he brings on Charlie Riley, he brings on Zach Robinson. Great opportunities for these guys, Tom. These guys are struggling to get in the team. Go and do something that's going to force the manager's hand so that you're in the team going up to Ross County on Saturday. Sorry, excuse me. But they just didn't do that. None of them really did enough for me. And it was a really disappointing the way the game fizzled out. I know Rangers have got quality. So even though they're down to 10 men, Alan, they can still pass the ball when they've got it. But Dundee should have done a lot more with that extra man in possession than they did. And I think deep down, Tony Docherty would be disappointed in that.
That's three games in a row now. The other team's been reduced to 10 men as well. Hibs and Mallow and Dundee haven't won it.
It's only way they can stop Dundee this season.
Well, Dundee haven't won any of the games, though. That's the problem.
Well, it works.
One thing about
Ross County might start with 10 men on Saturday.
There's a worrying trend now with Dundee. We've been praising the defence and the goalkeeper and what they've done, but there's a worrying trend that they're losing goals from set plays. They lost one against Hibs from a corner. They lost one from the second phase from a corner at Motherwell. And they've lost another one from a corner, Ibrox. That's not like them, Tom.
No.
They need to get out of their locker because
you look at the height in that defence.
Well, I'll tell you what, you're going to Ross County. they've got a lot of big guys when it comes to set plays, so Dundee will have to be on it up there.
Derek Adams is the type of manager that will, absolutely, if he sees a weakness, he'll try to exploit it.
There's nothing that will frustrate a boss as well more than conceding goals from set pieces, especially Tory Docherty, someone that's worked with Derek McInnes for so long. That was a coaching team that was very adept to taking advantage of set pieces.
They have been very, very strong at that. They don't, before that run, they'd only conceded one all season from any set piece. So.
Which makes it, that makes it tough for a manager, doesn't it? When you think you've got something sorted, it's working well,
and suddenly
out of the blue, there's a flaw there. It's often harder to
rectify. Point, because especially the personnel in general have been the same. You know, I know that Donnelly came in at the weekend there, and Lamy was out at Motherwell. But in general, you know, it's the guys who've done it for you in the past who are letting their guards slip a wee bit now. So I'm sure I'll tell you what they've been working on the training ground this week, because they are going to get, as you say, up at Ross County, a lot of big guys, a lot of six-footers, balls will be coming into Dundee's box on Saturday, and they'll have to deal with it much better than they've done in the last few games.
And the only thing that would frustrate me as an onlooker, just, and George will obviously have a better sense of how the momentum shifted, but last week we sat here and spoke about how Dundee will concede a goal at some point. And at Ibrox, that is just the fact of the matter. Don't concede another one and then another one. And they conceded three goals in 14 minutes. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it felt like a collapse is too strong a word, but it certainly doesn't make good reading on paper. And it was something that was so obvious that we pinpointed it last week, and it's disappointing that's the way it panned out. You know?
And it was that it was too easy for Rangers to score all three of those goals as well. As Bear mentioned, John McGee could have dealt with the first one, there was the penalty. Maybe a bit unfortunate, but still, you can't pull a shirt in the box. And then the third one is just a simple corner.
Yeah.
That really would have annoyed Tony Docherty. And an issue they may have in terms of defending on Saturday is it looks like Antonio Portales. I'd be very surprised if he's fit for Saturday. And that'll be a big blow, because he's been excellent since he came back into the team at Hibs. They immediately went and kept, what, 5 clean sheets in 6 games or something. First few, and he's looked really, really good on the right of that back three. So losing him, they obviously didn't have Owen Beck at Ibrox, and then Portales
might not have him on Saturday.
Yeah, well, going up to speak to the manager this afternoon, so hopefully find out if Beck's been training this week, because that would be massive. They're a different team with Owen Beck on that left flank. It's quite easy to see. So the two of them missing that didn't help, obviously, at Ibrox, because Portales went off just... He was behind the goal when that corner came in for the penalty. So you wonder if he might have helped in some way, or just losing a big defender. And there was a bit of confusion. You don't know whether maybe that had an impact on that, because I saw them screaming for Lyle Cameron to come back into the box because they were a man light.
Yeah. To use his height.
I think I would have said come back if you want.
Tom, you're right though. You're touching on something there, and I saw it on Saturday. And Dundee, for a while, they had a run of games. They were picking up wins, and they were looking good. And people were going, "We're in the top 6." And there was in some sectors talk of European football. I would say to Dundee fans, look, let's temper that. Let's have a look. I mean, I'm looking now. Dundee's battle this season is to stay in this league. There is absolutely no doubt about that. I'm looking at teams at top 6. I'm seeing teams that are much, much better equipped than Dundee at this point in time to take a top six place. And I look at the physical side. I know Dundee have good players, but to me, when you're playing Cameron, when you're playing
Luke McKinnon,
you know, they are a wee bit of lightweight. They bring on Tiffany. They are a wee bit of lightweight in certain areas where other teams are a bit more, you know, powerful. I look at that Kilmarnock side, I look at Hibs, powerful side, maybe a bit more experience. So let's make no doubts about this.
Yeah, Dundee's
challenge this season, Tom, is to stay in this league.
Yeah, I mean, with the intuition he always showed when he was sports editor, George Bear preempted my next point, is I'm still hearing top six, and I was just talking about United fans might panic if they lose on Saturday. I'm panicking already as a Dundee fan, and I look at the table and the season's gone as well, or possibly even slightly better than we could have hoped for so far. But they're still only 3 points above the playoff place. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I tend to think, like Bear, that let's not put the top six away in a dark cupboard somewhere and just concentrate on doing what you've been doing so far and try to get the gap to the bottom two bigger.
Yeah. To be fair, I think at the start of the season, if you offered Tony Docherty and his Dundee team an 8-point gap over bottom place at this stage of the season, they'd have snatched your hand off, I think.
I mean, the voice of doom here, Dundee do have a tradition of getting relegated as well as their bad seasons when they've been relegated. Every season's bad when you get relegated. They've had a few seasons when they've actually accumulated a reasonable number of points, but so has everyone else. And this is one of these seasons where most teams, Livingston apart just now, are winning games.
3 points separating five teams from seventh is pretty much says it all in terms of that battle to avoid 11th. Mm-hmm. I could not pick who will finish 11th. And what I would say is, having just had that big section at the beginning about how good both Dundee United and Raith Rovers are, I'm not sure this is the season to be finishing 11th, to be perfectly honest. So I'd probably put my house on Aberdeen not finishing 11th. They'll do something to get themselves out of that. But in terms of every other side there, that's going to be a hell of a battle.
St. Johnstone are on that. Ross County are on the up. Motherwell are possibly the one, but Motherwell, they're getting points. Motherwell are the one team, ironically, that aren't winning, but they're picking up.
Even though they're not winning,
a lot of draws.
They are picking up points here and there, And you just, if they can turn one or two of them into victories, they'll soon start climbing the table as well. And I'll tell you what, I mean, I know Livingston are struggling at this point in time. It's David Martindale's not going to give up the ghost. They'll still make a fist of it along the way. I mean, I saw them against Hibs. They were a wee bit unfortunate not to get someone from that game. But it's just for one reason or another, and there are problems off the pitch at Livingston just now as well, which I don't think are helping matters. David Martindale's too much of a battler to sort of lay down.
I read an article saying, is this the year that Livingston finally succumb? Well, they might get relegated, but they won't succumb to anything because they'll, whether they've finished bottom or not, they'll do exactly what they do.
Yeah.
And if that means fight all the way.
It just depends on whether they've actually got the quality.
Yeah.
And Bear's right to point out the off-the-pitch stuff. I mean, I'm not as kind of in the midst of it as I used to be, but, you know, it seems like...
Go and explain this thing that seems like an ownership issue but isn't an ownership issue. I heard that on the radio on Saturday and I could feel my head exploding.
Yeah, but it's not an ownership issue but as such.
That's
but
exactly what
I said. There's people with... vested interests in the club that aren't necessarily on the same page. I think it's suffice to say. And when you approach January and there needs to be work done on the squad in January, that would be the thing that would worry me as a Livingston supporter. I don't think they're dead and buried, but they need reinforcements in January, two or three players, and see if the people who sign the cheques aren't necessarily in the same page, then... That would be the bigger concern to me. That would actually, if you were a Livingston fan, would actually be more of a concern to me than the actual results just at the moment, because it's not a terrible team, but do they have the capability in January to add the couple of things that could spark a revival? I'm not necessarily sure they do, but as Bear says, you wouldn't be discounting anybody.
Going back to my beloved Dundee, I think they've had a great season so far, but I look at that table and I see half that league's in a relegation battle, and unfortunately Dundee are in that half.
Yeah, but that's why this Saturday's so big, because when you're coming up against the teams in that in that mix, you have to pick up results. That's just, and if you want to gatecrash that top six, which Dundee would like to do, obviously, but we'll wait and see if that happens. You then have to go and win games away at Ross County and pick up points along the next few, and definitely beat St Johnstone at home before the winter break. So you need to go and show you have the capability, which they have done in games previously. They dropped some points, which they're still kind of smarting about. But they need to get a win on the board again, because that's three games without a win, and suddenly when you get to four and then you've got Aberdeen and Celtic, it starts to get a wee bit.
I look at this game and it's a bit like the United Raith Rovers game. This is you can't say whatever happens on Saturday, this is a season-defining game, but if Dundee win this, you might, at the end of the season, say, That was the season defining game. That was the one that they pulled themselves away.
I'll tell you what, I'm gonna give you an all Dundee fans a warning. 2 years ago, right almost to the same weekend, Dundee went up to Ross County in a similar position. They were 5 points, actually 5 points clear of Ross County. They were leading 2-1 well into the second half, you know, to go 8 points clear, which we're talking about an 8 point gap, you know, on someone. And Ross County turned it around and won the game 3-2. And Dundee threw it away. There was a couple of big errors. I think Adam Legsdon didn't cover himself in glory with a couple of things. But anyway, Dundee lost the game, Alan. And by the time we'd got to the first or second weekend in January, a club that could have been 8 points behind Dundee were suddenly 3 or 4 points ahead of Dundee in the table. And that's the sort of thing that can happen. So Dundee need to get back to doing what I'll be interested to see how Dundee perform this weekend. I mean, obviously you'd like to go up there and get a victory, but I'll tell you what, for me, and nothing's up draw.
Yeah.
I would take that because it would be a point, and two, it would show they've still got clean sheets in them, Tam. It would show that they can still defend properly against a tough, tough side. So yeah, I mean, it's going to be a hard game, but yeah, the warning signs are there for Dundee at this point in time. They've been able to keep their heads above the sort of relegation buffer. And if they can do that through the course of the winter, coming into the spring, you know, they'll be fine. What you don't want is to start going on a slide and seeing teams jumping above
it. We have to say, I mean, Tony Docherty and his players, if they're daft enough to listen to this, could be sitting going, what are you talking about? We've been doing well, we're going well.
And
they're quite right to think that way. But I go back to the point about fan confidence. We've seen all this before. So have Dundee fans. We've seen this thing where it goes wrong in these type of games. And that's where the worry comes. You can't, I mean, it's maybe irrational in one sense, but because we've seen games like this prove very costly come the end of the season, I'm panicking.
what I would say to counter that panic is, though, that
just give us a Valium, John.
This Dundee team is stronger than that Dundee team, that's what I say, it's
unfair, and if you're in that dressing room it's probably unfathomable as well, because they'll look a decent, a really decent Premier League team, but we've got history unfortunately on our side, and it's a dark side. Somebody say something. I'm a nervous wreck.
I think Dundee will do well on that.
Yeah, I hope
and
so.
I think that Dundee,
well, they're capable
from an outside perspective with no trauma or skin in the game. Dundee seem a fine top flight team. I don't think they'll trouble the top six, but I have seen several far worse Premiership teams this season than Dundee have been at any point. So I wouldn't be inclined to worry, but that obviously shouldn't translate into complacency, and I'm sure it won't. But I think there's a lot of worse teams than Dundee in this division based on what I've seen.
I think Dundee, by any standards, are a decent Premier League team, but I've got irrational fear.
Yeah, and I think as well, you've got to look at the opposition. Ross County, I mean, Derek Adams has given a big kick up the backside, and, you know, you just know that they're going to be in Dundee's face. You know that any corner kick, there's not going to be any short corner kicks, there's not going to be any short free kicks. They are going to be putting balls into the mix, getting guys like Jordan White. They've got a few big defenders that come up for them. Simon Murray can be a handful of these sort of things as well. And Dundee are going to be really tested.
Do you mean Dundee fan Simon Murray?
Yeah.
Don't forget your roots, Simon. Exactly. Where do your loyalties lie, Simon?
Exactly, Simon.
He's actually the last.
I can see his two fingers raised.
He's actually the last Dundee man to score a winner.
Yeah.
Dingwall.
Yeah.
So, and that kept Dundee up in the division that season. So they've had some good...
Are you suggesting he scores an own goal?
No.
I just hope you enjoy your trip more than my last one. That 4-0 defeat that Dundee United took last time might have been the worst Dundee United performance I've witnessed, and I've seen them ship 9 and 7.
To the festive theme, my idea when I was working of a good Christmas was no December or January trips to Inverness or Ross County. Yeah.
I'm looking forward to it. But
I liked the games once I was there, but it was the journey.
To be fair, Dundee have a pretty decent record up at Dingwall. It's far better than Inverness, certainly. They've won quite a few, and they had some really good moments. I was having a wee look back. I'd done a piece for this lunchtime looking back at some of the moments that included That last
well,
one.
Well, that was McCowan it. Louis McCowan scored. I'll tell you what, he got two,
didn't
he?
Two, yeah, yeah.
He scored a couple of great goals, and he actually had an opportunity to get a hat trick. He was through, and the keeper pulled off a fine save, or that would have went to 3-1. You would have thought it would have been game over. But.
And there was a lot of Marco Harris scored an absolute ripper up there. Rory Loy got a couple. Dundee was 3-0 up after an hour at one point. And then Ian Davidson is the pick of the bunch. I don't know if you remember that one, 30 yards out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Rattles in it. That was the Team 12 season, or Club 12, sorry, or whatever it was. He smashed it in the top corner from 30 yards. I'm not sure he's ever done it again.
You're making me feel a bit more confident now, George.
Yes. And George, I'll give you the chance to continue this positivity. Going to get an early Christmas present with some good news on Owen Beck. I don't mean his injury.
Well, I hope he's playing on Saturday because he's a joy to watch.
But looking further ahead, George,
I think
your crystal ball.
We're waiting to kind of find out exactly what the decision is going to, whether he sticks
George,
around.
I want to open my presents now.
I think he'll be sticking around. It's not been confirmed yet, but I think it will be.
That's certainly good news. And I think that's a good way to end. And next week, we might even have 2.5 Christmas jumpers.